Actually, Celia, can you put that third verse back up? We're going to leave that up. I'd like to take a moment and break from our normal elements of worship and pray especially for Olivia Beaker as she is getting ready to head tomorrow with her mother to St. Cloud, Minnesota for this special treatment that we've all sacrificed to help them be able to do because insurance wasn't able to cover all the costs. And there's a special therapy equipment they have to have and special treatments that they have to have to help Olivia with her scoliosis. And so if you would like to come down and pray with the Beakers before they head out tomorrow morning, please make your way down. And we'll just spend a little bit of time in prayer for them before they head out tomorrow. This third verse seemed really appropriate to end on as we go to this time to pray for Olivia. There's still more coming. I'm going to wait just a second. Okay. Let's pray. Father, you have all power. And we know that our efforts and the efforts of doctors are only going to be successful when they're in harmony with you. Father, we've done what we feel you wanted us to do in order to prepare for this day, to prepare for this treatment. And so, Father, we ask your blessing upon it, upon the doctors, upon the therapy, upon the equipment that Olivia will be using. Father, we pray that it will be successful because of your blessing to allow Olivia to have the restoration of health and the restoration of her backbone and spine to be able to enjoy life the way you intended her to enjoy it. Father, we thank you so much for this family. They mean a lot to us. But Father, we are looking to you for your blessing and for your anointing on Olivia now as she goes and prepares to go for this treatment. Keep them safe as they travel. But Father, we pray that our efforts have not been in vain and that we are working in harmony with you to bring restoration and healing to Olivia now. And Father, help us not to take credit ourselves, but to give you the glory and the honor when she comes back healthy. Thank you again, Father, for loving us so much that you are our healer. You are the one that restores health. So help us to look to you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you all. As they're making their way back, if you take your Bibles and open up to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 32 through 40, that's where we're going to be spending our time today. And you're saying, but Pastor Keith, this is Palm Sunday. You need to understand something about the weird way your pastor's mind works. While I was in seminary, I began to understand that I had fully been so immersed in the Western way of thinking that I was totally oblivious to the way the Bible is presented, to the way the Bible as literature is presented, that I failed to understand a lot of the connections that are clearly there, but because of my Western mindset, couldn't see them. I don't know if you know it or not, but in the Western tradition of education, you have a very Aristotelian approach towards education. You go to science class and you learn science. Then you leave science class and you go out and you go to math class, you learn math. And you come out of math class and you go to history class and you learn history. Newsflash, that's not the way life comes to you. It comes to you as an integrated whole. And a more appropriate way of learning and of gaining education would be to integrate all of these disciplines together and to learn them as a whole, which the Bible assumes you've done, but unfortunately, we don't. Because in our Aristotelian and Western tradition, we segregate those, and we have to learn to integrate them. When I was in seminary, I learned that a Hebrew or a Jew or a rabbi will integrate information very, very easily, whereas we in Western tradition don't find those connections very easy at all. So my challenge to you is to think Jewish today and to integrate Deuteronomy chapter 4 into Palm Sunday. Pastor Keith, you're just in this. All things are possible with God, but this is way too far. No, it's really quite easy. Well, if you're thinking Jewishly, it's quite easy. And if I've been successful at the end of this message, you should be able to see the connections. Real quickly, what Moses is doing in this particular passage is showing how awesome God is. And how could the Jewish people, how could the Israelites not worship them when it's clear that God loved you so much to do what he did, bringing you out of Egypt, to do what he did for you and helping you beat these two kings already, to do what he did for you and delivering you from the Red Sea and to feed you in the wilderness for these 40 years. Oy vey, where are you at? What's wrong with your thinking that you don't understand that the God you serve is not like any other God? In fact, he spoke to you out of the fire and you didn't melt. You know, Raiders of the Lost Ark? That should have happened. But God was merciful to them. God wants to encourage them. God wants to bless them. And folks, if he blessed the people of Israel and they were able to see that or should have been able to see that in the Old Testament with Egypt and God delivering them from Egypt, how much more should we understand it and understanding Palm Sunday and Holy Week and God delivering us from all things? Palm Sunday is huge. It's the 10th of Nisan. And the 10th of Nisan was Lamb Selection Day in order for you to secure the lamb that you were going to sacrifice on Passover. So when Jesus comes into Jerusalem and is hailed as king, he's also basically saying, I'm willing to be your lamb. Will you choose me? Because in 4 days, they're going to have Passover. And they were required by law, according to the book of Exodus, they were required to select the lamb and live with it for the next 4 days in order to get a personal attachment to it. And then sacrifice it and kill it 4 days later. If you have been in 4-H, you understand that. You work with this animal, then you butcher it. Some of you have not worked in 4-H, and this is going right by your heads. Never mind, I won't even give you an illustration. It would be too brutal. This was Lamb Selection Day, but it also was King Coronation Day. Luke records in Luke chapter 19 that Jesus came into Jerusalem riding on this horse, and they're hailing him as king. There was an absolutely stunning message that I listened to by Ray Vanderland. I don't know if you know him. He's associated with the Focus on the Family, did the World That the World May Know series. But he gives a sermon in which he demonstrates that all of Holy Week, Jesus is going through the ceremonies that Caesar would normally go through to be coronated as Caesar of Rome. And that all the different little things that he does, all the things that are said about him, even to the point of refusing the wine filled with myrrh, all these little things were things that Caesar did as he ascended to the throne. And what Ray Vanderland so appropriately says is, all through Holy Week, Jesus is ascending to the throne. He's going there to die. Whereas Caesar ascends to the throne in order to dominate, in order to conquer, Jesus ascends to the throne in order to sacrifice for us. Our God is an awesome God. That's what I hope to be able to communicate today from Deuteronomy chapter 32 through 40. That's what I hope to be able to illustrate is what is happening here as we begin Holy Week. Our God could use his resources and his power and the authority that was given to him for his own selfish means, for his own agenda to dominate. But he chooses to use his resources and his authority and his power for us. That, there's no other. Listen very, very carefully as, Christy Plemons. As Christy Plemons comes and reads Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 32 through 40, listen for how awesome our God is. I'm sorry? Oh, I would have looked for my notes real quick.
Please stand. Ask now about the former days, long before your time, from the day God created man on the earth. Ask from one end of the heavens to the other. Has anything so great as this ever happened, or has anything like it ever been heard of? Has any other people heard the voice of God speaking out of fire as you have and lived? Has any God ever tried to take for himself one nation out of another nation by testings, by miraculous signs and wonders, by war, by a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, or by great and awesome deeds, like all the things the Lord your God did for you in Egypt before your very eyes? You were shown these things so that you might know that the Lord is God. Besides him, there is no other. From heaven, he made you hear his voice to discipline you. On earth, he showed you his great fire, and you heard his words from out of the fire. Because he loved your forefathers and chose their descendants after them, he brought you out of Egypt by his presence and his great strength, to drive out before you the nations greater and stronger than you, and to bring you into their land to give it to you for your inheritance as it is today. Acknowledge and take to heart this day that the Lord is God in heaven above and on the earth below. There is no other. Keep his decrees and commands, which I am giving you today, so that it may go well with you and your children after you, and that you may live long in the land the Lord your God gives you for all time. You may be seated.
If you want to pull out your sermon outline, I would encourage you to follow along, especially as I'm trying to make these connections between Deuteronomy chapter 4 and Palm Sunday. Hopefully the outline will be helpful for you to make those connections. The question we're trying to answer today is this. What is God, through Moses, trying to tell us in this passage? I believe the answer is this. God is like no other. God is like no other person. God is like no other God that's been invented throughout history. God is like no other. He is the all-powerful, all-knowing, ever-present creator of the universe who has chosen a people to be his own. He loves those people and has sacrificed greatly and disciplined them so that they can enjoy the best. One of the things you may have forgotten is that the first five books of the Bible is called the Pentateuch. They were written as a package by Moses. And a lot of times, Moses says things that he's assuming you understand from Genesis all the way through to the fourth chapter of Deuteronomy that you're keeping in your mind so that when he suggests certain things, they'll come up in your mind. One of the things that he's hoping you realize and hoping you remember is that God has created all this. And that God has made a covenant relationship with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and will keep that covenant relationship with them forever. Forever. That's why there continues to be an Israeli people, even though the rulers of the world for millennia have tried to eradicate them. Most of you have no clue how miraculous it is that there's an Israel in the armpit of the Mediterranean. Okay, you didn't need to see that, but it's a miracle. They were dispersed in 70 AD to the four corners of the world, and for almost two entire millennia, ceased to be a people, only in name only. And yet God sought to, two millennia. Folks, if the people of the United States were to be scattered all over the world, can you imagine us 2,000 years from now coming back together and becoming a nation again? No way. No way. Why is there an Israel? Because God said, I will make a covenant with Abraham and his people forever. And he's been good with that covenant. And that ought to get our attention, because there's no God like our God. The word for the day is awesome. We serve an awesome God. And Palm Sunday is a revelation of that awesomeness because of what Jesus is going to do for us. We fail to really worship appropriately. We fail to worship accurately. We fail to worship in spirit and truth as Jesus says we should worship because we just don't see God as he is. We are so clouded with our own distortion and our own confused minds and our own corruption and our own sin that we fail to see God the way he really is. To be quite honest with you, we've not been trained to see God as he really is. There's a great story that Bradshaw reminded me of in the Bible in 1 Samuel chapter 3. Anybody know that story and how it's appropriate for what I'm saying right now? I'll give you $5 if you can say. Time's up. Going to be 3 more seconds. 3, 2, 1. What? My wife? I get to give it to my wife. Samuel. Yes, Eli? I didn't call you. Samuel. Yes, Eli? Samuel, I didn't call you. Samuel. Yes, Eli? Samuel, have you ever heard the word of the Lord? It was God calling me? Go back and say, yes, Lord. Oh. Samuel, yes, Lord? Have you heard? Have you been trained to hear? Most of us have a God we've created in our own minds, and that's what God we're trying to listen to, and he doesn't exist. The God that truly exists is, is a God right here. The God that has chosen to reveal himself in the Word and in nature. And if we create a God of our own liking, if we create a God of our own making, if we create a God of our own imagination, he cannot respond to us because he doesn't exist. I get very nervous when I preach truth and someone comes up to me and says, well, my God would never do that. It's really hard for me to be gentle at that point. Did that communicate? We need to seek the God that really exists. We need to be trained by God and his Spirit and his Word to listen for God. We need to understand that the God of the universe is an awesome God that wants to connect with us, but he's unable to because we're listening. So, did you hear about the Indian that was in New York City? I don't know if you've ever been in New York City, but this is just noisy. Even at 4 a.m, it's noisy. We were in a motel. What street were we on? 46th Street? Something like that. It's just around the corner from Broadway where And it was noisy at 4 a.m. And during the day, all this stuff going on. An Indian was walking down the street one day, and he went, did you hear that? And the guy that was with him said, hear what? I mean, there's honking and there's people screaming and there's all sorts of blaring music and everything else. And he said, there it is again. Did you hear that? The guy said, hear what? And the Indian said, I heard a cricket. How could he hear a cricket in the middle of New York City? Because that's what he wanted to hear. That'll preach, but another Sunday. What's God like? One, God is the all-powerful, all-knowing, ever-present creator of the universe who has chosen a people to be his own. I read a book in the late 1960s. The book title was, Your God is Too Small. That is true of every single one of us. Part of the problem is we have human minds that we've confined and restrained with our own human limitations. And because now we're a fallen people and we don't have the mind of Christ, we don't have this intimate relationship with the God of the universe, we think humanly about the world. We think humanly about reality. And so we try to shove God in a box. We try to make God fit our understanding of reality. Stop it. God refuses to go in a box. He loves kicking the walls of your box out, and it's so painful because we spend a lot of time building this box. Some of you have not wrestled with boxes before. I am the box Nazi. In so many ways. And you know what's the most painful thing? Is I'll work for years building this theological box that I think, now I understand God. Pew! Now I don't understand God. One of the really important things you need to realize is part of the Pentateuch, part of Genesis chapter 32, 34, somewhere in the 30s, is Jacob wrestling with God, wanting to know him. You need to learn to wrestle with God, because in the process of wrestling with him, you get to know him. God is the all-powerful, all-knowing, ever-present creator of the universe who has chosen a people to be his own. To think of creature and creator as alike, an essential being, is to rob God of his most of his attributes and reduce him to the status of a creature. It's in your sermon outline, A.W. Tozer. 2, what is God like? He loves those people and wants what is best for them and has sacrificed greatly, given his law to them, and will discipline them so that they can enjoy the best. Jesus coming into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, on Lamb Selection Day, as King of the universe, saying, I'm willing to be your Passover lamb. I'm willing to be the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. I'm willing to die for you, but you must choose me. Or that can't be possible. And the King of the universe is willing to suffer and die for us, mostly because he's the only one who can suffer and die for us. But that's a later point. 3, what is God like? God is so extraordinarily other, we fail to experience him. You were shown these things so that you might know the Lord is God. Beside him, though, there is no other. I love this quote. It's given by G.I. Packer. It should be in your sermon outline. Your thoughts of God are too human, said Luther to Erasmus. This is where most of us go astray. Our thoughts of God are not great enough. We fail to reckon with the reality of his limitless wisdom and power. Because we ourselves are limited and weak, we imagine that at some points God is too, and find it hard to believe that he is not. We think of God as too much like what we are. Put this mistake right, says God. Learn to acknowledge the full majesty of your incomparable God and Savior. Folks, we need to learn that the God of the universe is all-loving. In fact, his essential nature and attribute is love. Ours is not. Our essential nature, our default nature, is selfishness. It's only by the Spirit of God working in us that we can rise above that, that we can actually be loving and concerned about others and giving. I don't know about you all, but it takes an extra conscious effort for me. I do just not normally flow out love. In fact, when I'm most me, I am the most ugly. Because the raw, some of you are looking at me like, Pastor Keith, the raw, unadulterated, totally unveiled and stripped down Pastor Keith is when he's hungry and tired and doesn't have the energy to put up a front. Look, Nucky, I'm glad you haven't ever seen me that way. I don't think you've ever seen me that way. Okay, good. Nick lives with us, so. Oh, no, no. I never see you. When I have plenty of energy and when I'm really, really rested, I can be quite charming. My wife's laughing. But when I'm tired and hungry, it's the raw me. And the raw me is ugly. That is why we all need Jesus. Because folks, even though a lot of you appear charming, I know you well too well from Scripture. And there ain't a one of you here that doesn't get ugly from time to time. And it's amazing to watch your faces and see the spouse going, really? And the other person just goes, pff. God is so extraordinarily other, we fail to experience him. Everything, every move, every word, every command, every action, everything God has ever done is based on and built on love. Pastor Keith, the eradication of the Egyptian soldiers in the Red Sea was not loving. Oh, yes, it was. Pastor Keith, you can't tell me that when God prescribed Joshua to go into the promised land and kill all the women and children and babies and everybody else and to eradicate and clean out the land, you can't tell me that was loving. Oh, yes, it was. And for you not to understand that means you don't understand that. You don't know enough about the data. You don't know enough about the story in order to know what God was doing, because it was loving, the only loving thing he could do. I got to keep moving because this is good. Oh, did you hear Jesus in the Palm Sunday when the Pharisees are telling Jesus, tell your disciples to shut up. You hear what he said? If you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. If you, people of God, here at the Hillsdale Free Methodist Church, even you, had known this day what would bring you peace, but for some of you, it's hidden from your eyes. And you're going through life absolutely distraught and depressed and worried and anxious and nervous and fearful. The God of the universe is crying out, hear me, see me, touch me, know me. I came to bring you life in all of its abundance, not to live life in fear and anxiousness and worry. Good preaching, Pastor Keith. Well, I'm trying. Number four, what is God like? God is so other, we fail to accept that there is no other. Verse 39, acknowledge and take to heart this day that the Lord is God in heaven above and on earth below. There is no other. Do you remember when Jesus was talking to his disciples and he encouraged all the disciples that were following him, maybe thousands of people, because it's in context with this huge throng that was watching Jesus. And he was teaching about eating his body and drinking his blood. And people went, whoa, that's way too far for me. And they backed off and left. And there was just the disciples there. And Jesus says to the disciples, are you going to leave too? Do you remember Peter's response? Where are we going to go? You alone hold the words of eternal life. And then later on in the book of John, chapter 14, Jesus himself says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody can get to the Father except through me. Folks, there's no other way but Jesus. Because there's no way to get to a holy, righteous, pure God other than someone to take away our sinfulness and give us his righteousness. Because it's not just enough to take the sins away. You're still just zero. You must be given holiness and righteousness and purity to even begin to have a relationship with the God of the universe. That's why God made him, Jesus, who had no sin, to become sin for us, so that in him, in Jesus, we might become the righteousness of God. Listen, Pastor Keith isn't just charming from time to time. I know that's a stretch for a lot of you. That's okay. It's put there for the humor value, but it failed miserably. Pastor Keith enjoys the righteousness of God, not on my own merits, not on my own abilities, but Pastor Keith enjoys the righteousness of God given to him by Jesus. Because I'm trusting in Jesus, because I ceased trusting in myself for my salvation a long time ago, because the harder I worked, the more trouble I got into. Because it was all from me, and I was the problem. That's why trusting in Jesus is the only way we're ever going to be righteous. He is so other, we fail to accept that there is no other. That's why we need to select Jesus on this Palm Sunday Lamb Selection Day. Worship point: to know God is to worship God. If you struggled to worship God, I'd have to maintain you don't know him. I remember Francis Chan one time, I think it's in Crazy Love, I can't remember now which book it's in, but Francis Chan says this: isn't it great we have a God that we can't exaggerate? Now, my imagination loves to run with that. But folks, isn't it great that we worship a God we can't exaggerate? Anything you can create in your mind about power, God having power, doesn't hold a candle to reality. Anything you can create in your mind about God's love for us doesn't hold a candle to how he really is. To know God is to worship God. If you struggle to worship God, you simply don't know him. I have a quote, I think it's in your sermon outline. If God is small enough for us to understand, he isn't big enough for us to worship. Some of you come to me from time to time and ask me Bible questions, and I have to say, you know, I have no clue. Especially if it comes from Ezekiel, Zechariah, or Revelation chapter 5 and later. Have you read Ezekiel? Have you read Zechariah? Have you read chapter 5 of Revelation and later? You know what's really strange about the book of Revelation? It tells you at the very beginning, you are blessed if you read it. It doesn't say you're blessed if you understand it. Some of you have a problem with that last statement. I can tell. Your faces betray way too much. Please don't play poker. Listen, my life has put me on a strange track because I was born into this world shortly after Israel became a nation. And I was born in this world when all of a sudden theologians had to look at the scriptures and eschatology, the end time prophecies of scripture. They had to look at it a new way. Because commentaries before 1948, all the way back, Calvin, Luther, all those said, well, obviously when God talks about restoring Israel, he didn't mean a physical Israel. He meant a spiritual Israel because Israel's no more. Well, guess what? They're back. And we have to wrestle with that. And all of a sudden, these scriptures that for years were meaningless now have popped up and go, we got people hawking over magazines and newspapers and everything else. I mean, you know these guys, right? Why? Because now we're beginning to understand what for years and years. There's a passage in Revelation that said that there's going to be a mark on everybody and they'll be able to keep track of everything that is bought and sold over the whole world. And people for years said, well, that's obviously figurative language because there's no way anybody could keep track of what's bought and sold over the world. Guess what? 21st century's here. That's no problem. Nobody in Western civilization has any problem at all recognizing the reality and the possibility of that scripture being fulfilled. Some of you are going, where does it say that? Oh, see me later. Folks, we need to look at God's word. We need to absorb God's word. And you may not understand it. Good! That means you're getting more in touch with the God of the universe. If you understand everything you read in the scriptures, you're brain dead. Some of you are offended with that. You're hearing God. God is, if you're really in touch with the God of the universe, he's speaking to you. Shouldn't you get at least every once in a while something you go, huh? Okay, you don't have to agree with me, but you haven't read Zechariah. To know God is to worship God. Gospel application: God is so holy, God is so righteous, he is so pure and just that he cannot endure sin of any kind. The only way We can have an intimate personal relationship with God of the universe is by being in Christ, who is holy, righteous, pure, and just for us. We see God when we see Jesus. That is why Palm Sunday is so absolutely huge. Jesus came on the donkey as King of the universe and said, "This is Lamb Selection Day. Will you pick me? Because if you pick me, I will be your Lamb that will take away the sins of the world, that will take away your sins so that you can have an intimate relationship with the God of the universe. Not only because your sins have been taken away, but because my righteousness will be given to you as a gift. My perfect righteousness, my righteousness of God. I have the righteousness of God." That's what Jesus said. That's what Paul said. Spiritual challenge. Seek to have the personal relationship that God desires to have with you. Never forget that there is no way this can happen outside of your being in Christ. Your sensitivities, your alertness, your perceptions, your discernment will not be in harmony with the God of the universe unless you've asked Christ into your life. You need the Spirit of God to have the mind of Christ. You need the Spirit of God to be in touch, to have your eyes open. Do you know there are two birds that live in the desert? Vultures and hummingbirds. Vultures look for dead stuff and feed on that. Hummingbirds look for cactus blossoms and feed on that. Guess how they both survive? They find what they're looking for. What are you looking for? That which is alive and a flower blossom and fragrant and full of life? Or are you looking for that which is dead, which is the things of this world? You have to have the mind of Christ to even be alert to the blossoms of life. You have to have the mind of Christ to even know not to look for the dead meat. So what? If you fail to enjoy a personal relationship with God in the universe, it could be very well be you either have unconfessed sin or you're not looking for the God who is like no other. I'd like to close with reading a portion of the book. I don't know if you knew it or not, but the book, The Robe, was written by a guy that in his life was trying to find information to discredit the gospel, to discredit Jesus, and to show that Jesus was a hoax. But he came to faith in Jesus and came to very, very vivid faith in Jesus by doing his investigation into the life of Jesus. In the book, The Robe, Douglas says this in page 401. Paulus is talking to Marcellus. There are two Roman soldiers and they're talking to each other. And this is what they have to say. "Consider these tales about Jesus, Paulus. He is reputed to have made blind men see. There's no story that he made any man blind. He is said to have changed water into wine. There is no story about him changing wine into water. He made a crippled child walk. He never made any child a cripple." "Excellent," applauded Paulus. "The kings have always been destroyers and despoilers. They have made men blind, crippled, broken." He paused and went on, muttering half to himself, "Wouldn't the world be surprised if once it should have a government that came to the rescue of the blind and sick and lame? By gods, I wish this absurd tale about the Galilean were true." They are. God is a God unlike any other. And Holy Week is our real indication about how totally other he is. He's not like any person. He's not like you. He's not like any government. He's not like any other ruler. Please see how incredibly loving God is as you go through this Holy Week and remember all that he's done for you. Because we were not lovable. We're an absolute pain. And yet God loves us anyway. Let's pray. Father, help us.